Hello students, so student, in the previous class in the chapter that is microorganism, we were talking about the different types of a microorganism. So we discussed that what are bacteria. We had also studied about that of the fungi. So you see student, if we talk about the fungus, so we have seen that the places where the fungus usually grow is dark, is moist and warm. So this is why this is the suitable condition for the fungus to grow. If we talk about that of the fungus only, so fungus basically it lack chlorophyll, and since it do not have a chlorophyll, so it is not able to perform the process of photosynthesis also. And process of photosynthesis, if it is not able to perform the process of photosynthesis, so not able to make their own food. Now if we talk about the other microorganism, basically you see student, if we say that a fungus is normally it not able to perform the so that is why they are saprophytic. It means they used to stay on or grow on a dead and decaying organic matter, and where they opt from there, where they obtain food. But sometimes it happens that it can also feed on the living things and causes an ethylate food, which is a kind of a disease. Now the second next type of a microorganism, if we talk, so that is protozoa. So protozoa, it we can say that these are basically a single cell, okay, and means unicellular. And protozoa is basically they are found in different places. So they used to change the place in search of food, okay, and they are parasitic. Okay, so they obtain their food from the other person. They obtain, they used to feed, or they used to take their food from the other living organisms. An example of protozoa, plasmodium is there, paramecium is there. So these are what, these are the type of the protozoa also. Okay, now the next one which we have seen is the algae. So in case of a algae student, so most of the time algae, most of the algae you can say lives in the water, and they consisting of a chlorophyll. So since they consisting of a chlorophyll, so they are able to perform the photosynthesis, and thus they are able to make their own food also. So we can say that algae they have chlorophyll and can make the food. Now there are a type of algae students. Although if we talk about the algae, so Spirogyra and Chlamydomonas, it is an example of the algae. But there are algae which lives inside to that of seas and oceans. So they are basically found in seaweeds, seaweeds, and that of a kelp is a type of a algae which is found deep in the ocean and seas. And they used to grow and become large also. So they are larger in size. If you talk about the kelp, so kelp basically it is 200 meter in height. So it is larger in size. So this was about the algae also. Now we have started to understand the another microorganism, and that is viruses. Viruses, students. If we talk about the viruses, basically they are very tiny. So we said that these are very small. Okay, they are very small, that these are this much small that they can be seen only through a high power electron microscope. High power electron microscope. Okay, so we can say that these of are of a very high power, and thus they can be seen only through a high power electron microscope. So we have studied here one thing also, student, and that is the viruses, they can exist in two states, and these two states are the living state and the non-living state. So basically, when the virus is at inactive state, so at that time we call the virus as virions, and as they come in contact with a living organism, they become active and they start growing and show the effect. Okay, so we can say that a virus exists in two state. Virus exists in two state. That is, virus exists in two state. That is, living and non-living. Living and non-living. So it basically exists in two state. That is, living and non-living. So it is like a non-living. It is like a non-living. Non-living means what? It is not showing any kind of a process. That is what we call the non-living, okay? So no metabolic process has been shown by the viruses at this state, and that is why we use the term that is non-living state. So at a state of a non-living, so it is like a non-living when not in contact with a living, okay? Contact with the living cell or a body. Okay, so you can see here, student, that it will be like a non-living when it is not in contact with anyone, or it is not present in a living cell or a body, because the living cell and the body will provide the sufficient environment for the viruses to grow. Okay, so this is what, at this state we will say that it is like a non-living, or we can say it is what, it is an inactive state of a virus. Okay, so here is another term we can write, that is the non-living state. The non-living state is also called as virions. This state is also called as virions. Okay, so we can say that this is the viruses at that time. The virus is at inactive state. Okay, so we can also write it that non-living state is what? It is an inactive state. Okay, so we can write it non-living state is also called as inactive state. Okay, this was about the non-living state. Now let us see that what happened when it come in contact with a living cell or in our body. So at that time it become active, and we will say that is what, that is the living state. Okay, so we can write it, it becomes alive when it come in contact with, when it comes with, comes in contact with a living body or a cell. Okay, comes, when it comes in contact with a living body or cell. Okay, so it becomes alive when it comes in contact with a living body or a cell. That is what, that is the living state of the virus. Non-living state or the living cell. Now this state is also called as active state. So we can write it that living state is also called as active state. Living state is also called as an active state. Okay, so So basically what happened, when it comes in contact with that of a living body or living cell, it starts reproducing, it starts increasing its number. So you know that this is what? This is the property of a living organism. It is a property of a living thing that it used to reproduce, it used to increase its size. Okay, so we can say that at living state, it starts reproducing. Okay, at living state, it starts reproducing. When we talk about the viruses, so viruses, what is the nature of the virus? So basically viruses are parasitic in nature. It means it used to obtain its food from the other living organism. So we will say that viruses are parasitic in nature. They are parasitic. Now, what are the different examples of the viruses, students? So you see that a lot of virus is there, student, which cause a very common virus. You have heard about a disease that is known as AIDS. So HIV virus, okay, human immunodeficiency virus is the virus which is used to cause the AIDS to a person. Coronavirus, very common virus these days, you know that COVID-19. So coronavirus is also a virus and it causes a disease called SARS also and COVID-19. Okay, so a lot of examples are there of viruses. So common one is HIV, corona. Okay. HIV virus, which is also called as human immunodeficiency virus. TMV. TMV is what? Tobacco mosaic virus. So it occurs in the plants. Tobacco mosaic virus. Tobacco mosaic virus. Rhinovirus is also there, student. Rhinovirus. Okay. Corona. Okay. So these are some of the examples of the virus. So we have seen here that what are the different kind of a microorganism and how they used to affect a person body. Okay, so we have understood that there are microorganisms which are harmful. We have seen here it is bacteria, it is fungi, it is the protozoa, algae, or that of the viruses. They cause a disease to us. So they are what? They are somehow harmful to us. Now let us see that we discussed that there are type of microorganism. So there are microorganisms which are useful also. Useful? Yes. Microorganisms are also useful to us. So let us see that how these viruses are helpful for us, how they are useful to us. Okay. So you see, students, useful microorganism. Useful microorganisms. So basically, if we talk about the microorganism, so when we talk about microorganisms, so we say that microorganism is not good for us. But it is not like that. There are microorganisms which are very good, which are useful to us. So these microorganisms are used for agriculture purpose, even for the commercial purposes also. So a lot of example is there, student, like the bread formation, which is caused by yeast. okay, or curd. So curd, converting of a milk into the curd is also caused by a kind of a bacteria which is responsible for the viruses. Medicinal uses also there, making of the alcoholic beverages. So these are some of the examples in which we can say that we use microorganism to make we use microorganism for different purpose, and this is kind of a beneficial for us. Okay, so we can write it, the uses of microorganism are broadly classified. These are broadly classified into categories like commercial, agriculture, medicinal, and environment. Okay, so we will discuss about that, how it is useful in a commercial purpose, agriculture, medicinal, and environment. Okay, so we have seen here that the uses of microorganisms are broadly classified to commercial, agriculture, medicinal, and environment. Let us start with that of the commercial use. Okay, useful microorganism, in which we will discuss about that of the commercial uses. If we talk about the commercial uses, students, so first of all, we should know that this kind of a microorganism is used for making any food item, including that of the formation of a curd or that of the alcoholic beverages. Okay, so the first we will study here is the making of a curd. Making of curd. So milk is what? Milk consisting of a protein that is called casein, and there is a bacteria which is known as lactobacillus bacteria, which help in converting the milk into the curd. So you see, student, that if you want to obtain the curd, we can easily add the lactobacillus bacteria into that of the milk, in a lukewarm milk, which is the best temperature for the growth of the lactobacillus bacteria, and thus the milk get converted into curd. So you have seen that your mother, how she used to prepare the curd. So she used to take a small portion of a curd, she used to keep it in the fridge, and after that the next day in a lukewarm water, a lukewarm milk, it means the milk is little bit hot, you can say. Okay, in that she used to add that small portion of the curd. So when she added that, here the formation of a curd occurred. Okay, so this lactobacillus, it used to divide and help in converting the milk into the curd. So whole of the milk, to the next day you will find that it will get converted into milk. Okay, so for the conversion of the milk to the curd, bacteria is used, lactobacillus is responsible for that. So we can write it, curd contain a bacteria are called lactobacillus bacteria. Okay, if you look at the milk, so milk contain of a protein, milk contain a protein called casein, that is called as casein here. Now, how the curd formed? So, curd formed due to the reaction between the casein and that of the lactobacillus bacteria. Okay? So, curd is formed due to the reaction between the lactobacillus and casein. Okay, reaction between lactobacillus and casein. Okay, this is what how the formation of a curd occur. Okay, so what happened here, that when a spoonful of a lactobacillus bacteria, means a spoonful of a small portion of a curd which consisting of the lactobacillus bacteria, is added to the lukewarm milk, when a spoonful of bacteria added to the lukewarm milk, the lactobacillus present in the milk convert the milk into curd. Okay, so it used to convert the milk into curd. So you see here, student, what happened here. At first, the lactobacillus bacteria is there, which is responsible for conversion of the casein into the curd. It means it help in converting the milk into the curd, we can say. So basically, the reaction occur between the lactobacillus and casein. So when a small amount of a curd piece, when a spoonful of a curd is added in the lukewarm water, so here, the curd, that spoonful of curd consisting of a lactobacillus bacteria, and when this is added to the milk, so the lactobacillus bacteria start reacting with that of the casein which is present in the milk, and ultimately help in converting the casein into that of the curd. So we can say that due to the addition of this lactobacillus in the lukewarm milk, why we are using the term that is lukewarm milk, because here it is providing a suitable temperature for the growth of the, or for division of that of the lactobacillus bacteria, okay, and which help in converting the milk into the curd here. Now let us see the next one is making of bread. Making of bread. Making of a bread. Now, making, you can say, students, if you are talking about the bread, so breads are prepared through a fungi that is called yeast. So this yeast help in providing the softness to that of the bread, and as what happened here, it help in releasing of that carbon dioxide, which makes the bread very soft and fluffy. Okay, so we can write it that bread, cake, even the pastries, they all are made up with the help of the fungi that is called yeast. Bread, cake and pastries are used to be prepared by using a fungus called yeast. By using a fungus that is called yeast. Now, basically what happened, if suppose we want to make a bread, so flour and that of the yeast plus water, all these, even the baking soda, see, these all were needed to gather, and the formation of a dough occurred, and it is leave for a night, then what will happen, the yeast help in releasing that of the carbon dioxide, and this carbon dioxide, it rises up. Okay, and leaving the space and ultimately making it soft and spongy. Okay, so we can write it, to make bread flour, water, yeast, baking soda, are needed to gather, to form dough. They are needed to gather to form dough. Now this yeast, it mixes with the dough and it reproduces rapidly. We are mixing the yeast here, student, and you know that the yeast is what? It is a unicellular fungi. So it is a kind of a microorganism only. So what happened when you mix the yeast? So this yeast mixed with the dough starts reproducing. Okay, so it just starts reproducing rapidly and decomposes baking soda to produce carbon dioxide. Now this carbon dioxide This carbon dioxide rises up and escape the dough, forming hole there. Okay, forming holes in it, and thus makes it fluffy. Spongy and fluffy or porous. So you see here, students, we can see that when this yeast, it mixes with that of the dough, it starts reproducing, and when it starts reproducing, at that time it starts decomposing, it means it starts releasing the gas, and that is known as the carbon dioxide gas. So this carbon dioxide gas it starts coming out from the dough and it make the dough to little bit rise, and when it rises and escape out from the dough, leaving the space there, leaving the hole there, and then we can say that it make the bread very soft and fluffy and soft or porous. So we can say that the second one, that is making of the bread, fungi, that is yeast, is responsible. And yeast is also what? It is a microorganism, it is a fungus, fungi, unicellular fungi, which used to react with that of the bread, which used to react with the food and rises the food. So whenever you will add yeast in anything, the yeast will ultimately help in rising of that dough or that batter, and it will came out, escape out by rising that the dough and leaving the space there, which space will make the bread, make the cake, make the pastry porous and spongy. Okay.